Good morning, Robert Hill's my name, and it's my pleasure to welcome you all here this morning in opening the conference. I particularly welcome you at this hour when Andrea Koch, the heart and soul of this event, said, "Robert, you've got to turn up at 7 a.m. to open the conference." I said, "Nobody would be there." She said, "You don't understand. They're farmers. Would have done a day's work by then." Anyway, she was right, and thank you very much, and thank you for coming so early, which is important because we have a very full day ahead of us. I wanted to acknowledge a few people. There are so many special guests, but Michael Jeffrey, former sort of head of special forces, former Governor General, the government soil advocate. John Anderson, former Prime Minister, who's agreed to chair today for us. John, great to have you as part of this project. Giving the National Party a boost. Barnaby Joyce, who will be the Agricultural Minister, who will be joining us a bit later. And Brian Keating from CSIRO, Executive Director for Agriculture, Food and Health. I'm opening the event on behalf of the United States Study Center because our Chief Executive, Bates Gill, is one of those who couldn't get here from Sydney by 7 o'clock this morning, but will be with us a little later. The US Study Center, under the auspices of which this event is being held, was established by the Howard government to help underpin the Australian-US relationship through education, information, and joint work on projects where that work can benefit both countries, and this work in soil carbon has been one of those projects. As such, I want to thank the sponsors. The Dow Chemical Company. Dow has sponsored a sustainability program with the Centre for nearly 6 years now, almost since it began, and we very much appreciate the support of Dow. And also today, the New South Wales Department of Primary Industries. The US Study Centre is located at the University of Sydney, and we have a very good relationship with the university and appreciate that, but it also has a responsibility for the whole of the country. I particularly wanted to thank our Americans because we are the United States Study Centre, and as I said, we try to bring together Australians and US specialists to work together on common projects. So what we've been able to do today is to bring six American speakers to join us. We expect to learn from them. We hope that they will learn a little from us. And because they've traveled a long way, the Americans always tell you, Australia's a long way away. We say to them, you know, US is a long way away. I wanted to mention Dr. Sunny Ramaswamy, Director of the USDA National Institute for Food and Agriculture, Dr. Mike Strobel, Director of the USDA National Water and Climate Center, Mr. Mary Kay Thatcher, Senior Director, Congressional Relations, American Farm Bureau Federation, Dr. Pradip Das, Strategy and Operations Leader, Climate Corporation, Mr. Charles Schlushner, Manager, Product and Strategy from John Deere, and Dr. Terry Griffin, Griffin Consulting and Kansas State University. Thank you very much for traveling all this way and to be with us today. This project arose from original work that we were doing on soil carbon, and that in turn arose when a group of soil scientists actually from the University of Sydney came to us and said, we are concerned that so much of the world's soil asset has become degraded. And although we may have 50,000 soil scientists in our association, we don't think the broader public understands that and how important that will be in terms of agricultural productivity, food security, in terms of biodiversity conservation, in terms of retention of water, in so many ways. And this led us into the project of bringing Australian and United States scientists together and practitioners together to work out how we could communicate the change in practices that could result in a restoration and maintenance of soil carbon and better working of the natural system, the biological systems in the soil. Andrea Koch, being a farmer as well as having a technical background, took it one step further and said, even if the soil isn't degraded, it's very important that we understand the processes of life within soil, because actually, with a healthy soil, we could actually lead to even greater productivity, which is important. And Andrea then moved into the area of realising, because when we worked on soil, we needed to be able to measure, evaluate how more data used effectively could help deliver the outcomes that we were seeking. And so we have reached today where we are debating the issue of soils in terms of how big data can be used to more effectively and profitably manage rural resources. Andrew Koch, as I said, has been running this program at the US Study Centre since its beginning. She is the heart and soul of this event today, and it's my pleasure to welcome her to the podium.
Thank you very much for your kind words, Robert. Welcome, everybody. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this landmark conference, the first in Australia to discuss big data in agriculture, and the first in the world to consider ways in which how this technology can usher in a new era of managing soil productivity for agricultural profitability and productivity. It's through my unique position of understanding and developing relationships between Australia and the US that I've come to understand that the US is a little bit ahead of Australia in the public dialogue around big data. There's lots of conferences going on, lots of workshops. I attended a session last year in November in Long Beach and understood and started to hear what's being discussed in the US. And I thought it's probably time that we have a similar dialogue here in Australia. So today we're going to hear from some of the leaders in the field from the US, but also from our own Australian leaders on what the developments are, how big data and the Internet of Things are being applied at a sector level, and hopefully we'll get a sense of what is hype, what is reality, and where is this all heading. Now, if you're sitting there thinking, well, I don't know anything about big data, then that's absolutely fine because you're in good company. This is a conference where we start to learn about this and we start to get an understanding of what it's about. And so I encourage you to relax and to learn today. It's a very busy schedule, as Robert said, so there's a lot to be covered, and I'm hoping that you'll get a good sense of it by the end of the day. So on the second topic, which is the idea of digital soil management, I'd like to quote the late Professor William Albrecht, who was a very renowned soil scientist at the University of Missouri College of Agriculture from the 1930s. And he said, "You have to have a vision, otherwise nature will never reveal herself. Let me help you catch a vision." So I'd like to help you catch a vision today. And the vision is that farmers and graziers and land managers will have at their fingertips, on their devices, on their tractors, on their computers, a map of soil of their paddocks, detailed down the profile, and along with it, an understanding of the chemical, biological, and physical processes and functions that are occurring in the soil. And that they can, with that, that they can manage to optimise the growth of the plants that they're growing, be it crops, pasture or horticulture. And in doing so, that they'll simultaneously be optimising the health of the soil and the ability for that soil to provide the ecosystem services that we need, including fresh water and a regulated climate. What's going to enable this vision is technology. And today, you're going to hear about how far along towards that vision we already are. I believe that by working together, Australia and the US can really help drive forward this idea of digital soil management to boost farm productivity and also to give us the ecological and environmental outcomes that we're looking for. We have strong scientific collaborations already. And through the work of the Soil Policy Think Tank project at the United States Study Centre, we are aiming to strengthen and to strengthen these relationships and to collaborate further on issues of soil policy. I'll stop there because we do have a very full agenda today, so you'll need to keep your thinking and your concentrating caps on. But the good news is that we'll have a nice lunch to sit down to that'll give you a chance to catch your breath. And at the end of the day, we're going to have drinks for networking after the conference. So if you can get through the day, then there'll be a nice drink at the end. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce our chair for today, who is the Honourable John Anderson, former Deputy Prime Minister and leader of the National Party. I'm sure he needs no further introduction, so please welcome the Honourable John Anderson.
Well, Andrea, thank you very much. Terrific to be with you all this morning. Could I just particularly acknowledge my former colleague? We served for really the best part of a decade together, Robert Hill and I, and the Howard government years. I think we were a pretty good government, one way or another. I should thank him for the promotion that brings to mind a little while ago I was working with a charity, some of you might know it, Opportunity International. It's a microcredit bank, and we were doing some work in Indonesia. I was working with a businessman who was heading up a major hospitals program. And in conversation one day, he said to me, look, the next time you're in Indonesia, come and talk at my church. I thought, that's interesting, and I was ducking for time, so forth, and then eventually I was talked into it, cut the story short. I went along to this massive, massive brand new building. It had the biggest screen I have ever seen. I'm told it was the biggest in the Southern Hemisphere. A logo on one side, picture of me, a young Indonesian fellow came up to me and looked at the photograph, which was taken in about 2003. Looked back at me, look at the photo, back at me, an evil glint in the eye, said, just how long ago was this photo taken? But worse was to come. On the other side, it had in small writing up the top, and then this screen is absolutely massive. We welcome our guest, and then in massive writing, John Anderson, my name. Then the small print. You know, you're not actually meant to notice the small print. It had the two little words, former deputy, and then in massive writing, Prime Minister of Australia. I took a photograph of it. I have it as evidence when I need it in a conversation with Tony Abbott. I have a great interest in what you're talking about this morning, even though, as Andrea said, many of us don't know much about it. And it's terrific. We have the former Governor General here who's become such an advocate for soils in Australia today, Mike Jeffries, wherever he is. It's always good to have him with us. I think it's an incredibly important area. I'm a sixth generation farmer. The heavy soils of northwest New South Wales, soils that are at once both robust and fragile. They need to be carefully looked after, but they're highly productive. We seem to be able to punish them, but we've got to do a lot better with them in the future than we have in the past. We've come a long way. When I was a young farmer, before I started farming in the old days, 60s and 70s, when you finished your crop, you know, when you'd harvested it, you'd wait for a cool evening, not too dangerous in the heat of summer, you'd burn it off, and then you'd rip into it with a disc plough, throw soil everywhere, and then you'd wait for the summer storms to wash half of it away. It was terrible. We progressed then when I started out with shearer trash workers, trying to incorporate the trash using big John Deere tractors. Is somebody from John Deere here? One of these days I'll get somebody from John Deere to explain to me why green paint is so expensive. We quip that in farming circles. We know they're good. And we also know we pay a lot more for them in Australia than you do in America. But anyway, we progressed from there to minimum till, and that started to make a dramatic difference. Now we're all zero till, hardly a timed implement to be found on the place. And GPS, of course, steerage and all the rest of that. And yet, the whole game keeps moving. Talking to a farmer the other day, a bigger operation than ours, and he said, oh, you don't have enough data. And I felt offended because I thought we'd done such a good job in government, Rob, that he had all he could possibly have needed from his mobile phone tower. He's got four bars up there. See, I'm technologically illiterate. But he said, look, it just isn't enough. He said, I'm trying to run the show at any given time. I'm monitoring where six tractors are, four trucks are, and they move all over the country. I've got any number of utes running around the place. I need to know where people are. He's happily married. He doesn't need to know where his wife is. I've got water points that we're monitoring. And it's all requiring more and more and more capacity as we have this plethora of data coming at us, and we're looking for better and better ways to use it. Well, all of that is terrific stuff. We're going to learn a great deal. Andrea, I'm just really appreciative that you and yours have put this together. I'm sure we'll go away much the wiser. And it's incredibly important that Australian agriculture remains at the forefront where technology is concerned. We're not bad uptakers of innovation. We can do better. We really can. There are great differences, I might add, between industries. So cotton, I shouldn't say that, there's some cotton people here today. They'll go away swollen-headed, won't they? But they tend to be the quickest uptakers of all in Australia, reflecting the fact that it's a smallish and relatively new industry, small in terms of numbers of people involved. How many cotton farmers in Australia? 2,000? 2001. I'm now a cotton grower. Through to some of the other industries that are not so quick at uptaking technologies, we have to do better. We're in an international race in terms of competitiveness. Our cost structures are high. We have to make up for it in other ways. So thank you very much. This is a very valuable opportunity for all of us today. I'll do my best to keep you all on time, but it is now my great pleasure, Rob has said a little about Dr. Sonny Ramaswamy. He tells me he arrived at 4 o'clock yesterday and he's not jet-lagged. I was wondering why. I've since discovered it's because he's been interviewed by the ABC this morning. That's enough to sort of heart-start anybody. You have the CVs. I'm not going to spend a lot of time introducing people today because that'll hold people up. You do have a beautifully set out CV. As we come to each of the speakers, glance your eye over. You're a distinguished guest, sir. It's great to have you. I'll give you the podium.
Very kind introduction. Can you turn this on for me, please? Whoever's controlling the microphone, the lavalier. Are we on? Okay, good deal. Thanks very much. And thank you very much, Deputy Prime Minister John Anderson, for that kind introduction. Very short, very sweet. And again, I want to thank Andrea Koch and her staff as well for having me come here. And Tara Wolfson was particularly important in making sure that I was going to show up here. And I did show up at 4 in the afternoon yesterday. So great to be here. And I've got a remote control someplace, I think. Yes, indeed. Okay. So I want to, sometimes I feel like I don't know what I'm talking about. I get to do a lot of speeches around the country about various topics. And Andrea came over to the States here about a month ago, and we talked a little bit about what my overview is going to be about. And rather than getting into the soil piece of this conversation here today, I'm going to share with you a very broad 30,000-foot overview of the challenges that we face in regards to food and agriculture, and the critical role that big data is playing already, and it's going to have a bigger and bigger role as we go forward as well. So that's going to be the sort of conversation I want to have with you here in the next about 20 minutes or so that I'm scheduled to speak for. All right. The Deputy Prime Minister, in introducing me, said, look at the bio to get a little more detail about who I am. And I've been a professor for a very long time. And no professor starts class without asking a question of the students. And I want to go ahead and ask that question of the students here in this auditorium this morning. How many of you have seen the movie Interstellar? Oh, my gosh. Less than a third. That's terrible. Less than a quarter. So the rest of you need to get a life. Go see that movie, and it is, by the way, available on Netflix, and I assume that you guys have Netflix here in Australia as well. It's on DVD, it's on Blu-ray and all that. By the way, I'm not supposed to be a shill for Blu-ray or DVD or Netflix, but seriously, go check it out. It's a great movie. In that movie, we've got this hunk, Matthew McConaughey, and his counterpart is Anne Hathaway. And Matthew McConaughey, by the way, is a former astronaut with NASA, and now a farmer. And the movie opens up, and the scene, for those of you that have not seen the movie, and by the way, I'll not give the rest of the story away, you'll see corn and corn and corn and corn, and lots of dust. And somehow in the movie, you get to understand that some malady has struck planet Earth, and all we've got is corn. This malady is probably some sort of a pathogen. And Matthew McConaughey is called by NASA to figure out a path to get humanity off of Earth to some other planet. And, oh, by the way, Matthew McConaughey is a single parent, as a farmer. He's got a couple of children. And in the movie, as the movie starts off, he has to go for a parent-teacher conference as well. And in the parent-teacher conference, the character that's playing the teacher talks about how the world did not run out of airplanes and television sets and things like that. The world does not need any more engineers. My apologies to the engineers here. What we need are really a bunch of people that will figure out how to grow food. That's the premise of this movie. And incidentally, going back to his role as a NASA astronaut, the physicists are figuring out that they're going to go through these wormholes to get from point A to point B, because if you go through wormholes, the physicists tell us that you're going to get to point B faster. Never mind on the other side of the wormholes, we have what are called as black holes. And Stephen Hawking tells us black holes could do either two things, either nothing, or you could be sucked in like a vacuum cleaner. So in any case, these folks take off to go find another planet. By the way, in humanity's history, for a very long time, food has been the driver of mass migrations. As you know, we had the Irish potato famine back in the mid-1800s, that resulted in 2 million people dying in Ireland, and about 2 million people leaving Ireland to move to various parts of the world, North America and Australia and other places. In fact, in America, about a third of our population has Irish descent. And so we've had that happen. And then more recently, we've had, you know, the Dust Bowl era back in the 1930s. And in fact, Andrea, in her short introduction yesterday, the reception, talked about that happening here in Australia as well. And a consequence of that was people from the Midwest moved out to the West Coast. And we wouldn't see California that is today were not for the fact that there was this driver of this dust bowl that resulted in people moving. So we've had this history. And more recently, we've had people moving from Africa into Europe, from Asia into this part of the world as well, and from South America. Again, the driver has been food. Food's been the driver of all these migrations that we see. We see these in other animals as well. Whether it's wildebeest or monarch butterflies, we see these sorts of mass migrations taking place. So you have to go see the movie to get the rest of the story. Now, that's the Hollywood version. The reality version is NASA sent out a mission here about a few years ago called the Kepler mission. And this little bitty spacecraft that's gone out into the far reaches of space itself and has found what's referred to as the Kepler habitable zone. This is the, in quotes, the Goldilocks zone, just right. In fact, it has found multiple planets that are not unlike Earth. They have about the right diameter, and you want the right diameter in part because of gravity. And they're at the right distance away from their own sun. And they've got tantalizing evidence of liquid water, not frozen water, not gaseous water, but liquid water, critically important for us to survive as humanity, for plants and animals and other organisms as well. So that's the good news NASA has found. Well, the bad news is that the Kepler habitable zone is only 12 light years away. And, you know, when we learned in physics way back when we were young kids, Deputy Prime Minister Anderson, we learned that light travels at 186,000 miles per second. And now you can do the math as to how many years it would take us to get to 12 light years away. So we got what we've got, and we have to deal with it. And so it's not like we're going to get up and move to some other planet, contrary to what Hollywood tells us. So that's the whole context in which we're thinking of these challenges that we're thinking of. And the most critical challenge that we've got, and a lot of people frame this as food security, is not so much the fact that we need to have calories as much as we got to have nutritional outcomes that result from it. So I like to call it nutritional security. And I think as we're projecting out with this burgeoning population of over 9 billion people in just the next few years, and already it's happening, I think truly this is an existential threat that we've got, that we have to deal with it now, not something that we're going to be thinking of in a few years down the line. It is something we're going to have to get together and start rolling our sleeves up and figuring out how we're going to ensure the nutritional security of humanity itself. That's the context now, from a sort of an interstellar down to a local level. And I like to think that our ability to address this existential threat is really in regards to what I refer to as the Malthusian necessities of life. All organisms on Earth, animals, humans, etc., We need food, shelter, fiber, and fuel. And the proposition really is that we're going to ensure the food needs, the nutritional needs, et cetera, of this 9+ billion population. Oh, by the way, we're going to tie our hands behind our backs because we're going to throw at ourselves all these constraints, whether it's climate change or diminishing land and water resources or changing incomes and diets. You know, people in India and China and places like that, the burgeoning middle class, they're consuming a lot more animal protein, for example. And the impact of that, and they also want 2 television sets and 3 automobiles and on and on and on. All of these things are having a very significant impact on our ability to make sure that we meet the nutritional needs as well as other needs of humanity itself. And by the way, at the end of it all, we want to make sure that everybody's going to be healthy as well. Those health outcomes are critically important because of the debacle of obesity and type 2 diabetes and cardiovascular disease and things like that as well. So that's the proposition that we've got to worry about. And I like to think that there's a perfect storm right now, not something that's going to be happening in a few years down the pike. It is happening right now. And this perfect storm has a whole bunch of components to it. It's population, of course. It is climate. It's the extreme weather events that we're seeing. On to the funding needs that we've got. You know, in fact, governments are investing fewer and fewer resources into these public goods that we need. And then there's an expectation that the private sector is going to step up to be able to provide the funding that we need. The private sector, you know, with all due respect to the Monsantos and the Apples and others that are here and around the world, with all due respect, they're going to be investing in areas where they are going to be able to make some money. Not per se in the area of nutritional security, but where they can see an opportunity for them. The business plan needs to allow them to be able to make some money as well. So that's the challenge that we've had. Oh, by the way, we've also got an environment here in Australia, in the United States and other places, where people have started distrusting science. They're distrusting the intellectual pursuits as well that we see. You know, look at the conversation we have about climate change and the headbutting that we do as well. That's the context in which we have. And incidentally, the pipeline of young people that we need to continue to have come in to these enterprises to make not just the discoveries that we need, but also young people that are actually going to become farmers. You know, the Deputy Prime Minister asked, how many cotton farmers do we have here? But beyond cotton farmers, farming in general, what is it that we're going to be doing that allows young people to go ahead and partake of that, in quotes, I like to say the American way of life or the Australian way of life or whatever it is, that what is it that we do that enables young people to say, yes, I do want to be in part of this idea of the solution to meeting our nutritional security. Farmers have to put a few more dollars in their pockets. And in fact, last night, Graham Blight and Major General Jeffries were also talking about that. These have to be economic enterprises. It's not enough to say you're gonna give people food. At the end of the day, farmers have to be able to put a few more dollars in their pockets as well. That's a critically important part of what it is that we end up doing, the enabling things that we need to be doing as well. All right, so the path forward to addressing this perfect storm that we've got, of this existential threat that we've got, is we need a whole slew of these transformative discoveries, whether it's in all the omics and nanotechnology and agronomics and on and on and on, or the kind of 21st century science that we need, the 21st century extension that we need, the ability to translate knowledge into innovations and solutions. We continue to have that happen. Yeah, that is the extension piece of it that we need to have, along with changes that are taking place in farming systems and the education that we offer in regards to policies and regulations and marketing, et cetera, and the communications piece of it, because there's a distrust, as I said, and we're going to have to make sure that all these great technologies that are being invented and discovered, et cetera, don't leave people, you know, with angst. And look at the conversation we have in regards to GMOs today. It is that angst that needs to be dealt with. So really, the human dimensions aspects and the communications piece of it need to be also coming along very nicely. In fact, maybe even ahead of these great discoveries in big data and other places that we're doing as well. That's critically important for us to think of. And in regards to transformative discoveries that we need, I can go on and on for several hours about the things that are going on in that space. But I want to focus on 2 things. That's part of this conversation that we're having here today. Is what I refer to as the Internet of Agricultural Things and big data itself. And So a little bit about the Internet of Ag things. And in this realm, thinking of the 21st century farm, it looks like any farm that would have looked, you know, the Norman Rockwell painting that particularly in the United States were used to, you know, the rolling hills, the pastures, the barn, the couple of cows, a guy typically wearing bib overalls and a tractor, et cetera, et cetera. That has morphed in the 21st century. Of course, you see the same sort of things, except there's a whole bunch of sensors on that farm. Those sensors are in everything that is going on, whether it's on the tractors and the combines, on the self-steering combines or tractors, on the barns, the plants themselves. We're providing a lot of funding here in the state, in Australia and in the States and other parts of the world to use synthetic biology and systems biology approaches to make plants actually emit. And those sensors are basically farmers anymore today are data managers. They, in addition to being agronomists and animal scientists and soil scientists and everything else that farmers have to be, they have to be data scientists as well, because they are using these handheld devices to be able to interpret what this all means. Every part of that farm has got sensors on it. There's gobs of data that are being produced, and those data need to be integrated, and then the decisions that these farmers are going to be making is critically important in our ability to address this existential threat that I was referring to. And we've got robots running around in the soil, and these are like the Roomba devices that, again, we provide a good bit of funding. University of California, Davis, for example, we gave money here. They're developing these devices that can tell the difference between a weed plant and a crop plant. And if it has got these algorithms and sensors, it can smell, it can see a weed plant, et cetera, and make a decision, and then deploy a laser to zap that particular weed. Or it can go ahead and deploy UAVs to come in, as you know. And there's a, you know, really amazing levels of data that are coming out of all this, all of that being integrated. The beauty of this is there are several companies that have already capitalized on this capability. We've got Monsanto purchased the Climate Corp here a couple of years ago, and we've got Pradeep Das that's going to be speaking to the kind of work that they're doing out there. John Deere has Encirca, for example. This is all about prescriptive farming. And the idea there is to use data, and these data, by the way, are coming from the public domain primarily, and from the in quotes, the private domain as well. And I'll come back to these data as to the challenges that we've got, the who owns these data, these sorts of things. But right now, we have companies that are selling these sort of prescriptive farming tools to our producers here in Australia, in the United States, and other parts of the world as well. So that's the context of the Internet of Agricultural Things that we've got. It's all being enabled by this very disruptive invention of, in quotes, the internet. And that is interconnected everything that we've got. And because of that interconnectedness, we're able to utilize these sensors, the data that they're generating, and utilize it to make informed decisions as well. And we'll learn a lot more about it in the conversation later on today. And in the entire supply chain, just not on the farm itself, in the entire supply chain from the farm all the way to the dinner table and the trash can, we've got sensors that are being utilized that are producing massive amounts of data. And it's on all aspects in the supply chain that you can think of, whether it's on-farm production or soil health and water and nutrients or processing or the inspection that needs to occur as well. We have, for example, in the United States Food Safety Inspection Service, that's part of the U.S. Department of Agriculture. They go around to these meat packing plants, for example, and they're inspecting. And those are all providing data as well. There are sensors that are able to provide data in the form of, you know, in regards to food safety, smart refrigerators, shrink wrap that can tell you if your meat's gone bad or not, or your vegetables are getting old or not. Your cell phones, your smartphones are receiving information when you're out of the grocery store. And oh, by the way, when you're at the checkout counter of the grocery store, it's mind-boggling. It'll print out for you some coupons based on your buying habits, your purchasing habits. And oh, by the way, you get on Facebook, and it very nicely has determined your Facebook use pattern, your likes and et cetera, and your postings, and gives you a set of ads that are really based on your type of work. And that's all in this realm of big data itself, this gobs of data that we're leaving behind, this trail that we're leaving behind that's being utilized to provide information. And that's happening in the food world as well. And in regards to the supply chain itself, and the entire supply chain from the farm all the way into the trash can. And I'll say a little bit more about this trash can idea here. And that refers to this food waste and food loss area. You know, we need these great discoveries in big data and all the omics and things like that. But really, we've got some low-hanging fruit right now that we could deal with. We don't need to necessarily start as Graham Blight referred to last night. It's not about our ability to produce food. It is our inability to get food from where it's produced to where it needs to be and to avoid these losses and waste and all that. In the developing countries of the world, almost about half the food is lost before the dinner table. In the developed world, including Australia, about a third to half of the food is lost after the dinner table. And indeed, the Economic Research Service, that's a bad graphic for you, but they provided a study last year in April in 2014. They said in the United States, just in the United States, collectively, we're wasting 131 billion with a B pounds of food per year. That translates to 1,200 calories per man, woman, and child in the United States. For an average adult to thrive, we just need about 18 to 2,200 calories. Of course, in America, we eat more than 3,600 calories. And of course, we got all the problems with obesity and things like that, too. But seriously, we're losing about half the caloric needs in our trash cans. And, we're talking about doubling food production in the next few years. We need the water. We need the land. We need 186 million more hectares of land. By the way, that food waste, food loss, collectively, globally, we're losing 1 quadrillion liters of water per year. 1 quadrillion liters. And it turns out there's a study that was done. In the year 2030, we'll have a 40%, based on today's technology, we'll have a 40% gap between the amount of water available and the amount of water we need. And that equates to that 1 quadrillion liters of water. And we can deal with these water issues we've got. We can deal with the food needs. We can deal with the nutritional security right now, picking up on the comments that Mr. Blight made last night as well, in addition to continuing to produce food as well. Okay, that's the low-hanging fruit that we need to be thinking of. How do we deploy big data into it? How do we go ahead and take trash cans, for example, that are smart trash cans that can go ahead and take the organic waste and convert them into compost, utilizing the drivers that we've got, the big data type drivers that we've got, be able to do things a little bit smarter as well in regards to smart agriculture that we're thinking of, the conversation that's going to ensue here the rest of the day as well. In addition to the low-hanging fruit in regards to food waste and food loss is the area of precision foods. Last year, President Obama came up with this concept called precision medicine. That is, there's a lot of information, a lot of data that's resulting from all the omics and other things that we've been doing in the human health area, got it. And that in the precision foods area as well, we can do humans, individuals, genome and epigenome and the microbiome. You can match that with the plant, animal genome, epigenome, and the microbiome as well. And you combine that with all these wearable sensors that we've got, everything from Fitbit and Apple Watch to wearable clothes that are constantly picking up information. In fact, one of those, Athos and Hexaskin and Jimmy, by the way, is an Australian company that's developing these wearable clothes that are constantly providing data on your metabolism, your caloric needs, your exercising and things like that. All of that brought together and combined in, you know, developing these super trackers, again, being driven by big data, getting all these data, helping people be much smarter about the food they consume so they don't overconsume. You see all the attendant issues that we've got about, you know, in America, we have a third of our population that's overweight and another third is obese. And so these are the sorts of challenges that we can indeed address in thinking of precision foods as the possibilities as well. All right, very quickly about big data itself. And the milieu of the big data is, again, pretty mind-boggling. It's big. No pun intended here. And it's everything from the analytics and informatics to the evidence-based tools to machine learning to neural network services and spatial analytics and the bandwidth and on and on. All of these are part of that milieu in which big data is being developed. And this is going to be the enabler of the kinds of things that we do. So it's a pretty big milieu. And how do you bring all this together in figuring out tools and apps and things that our farmers, our livestock producers are able to utilize, and being able to, you know, do the things that we need in the precision foods area, in dealing with the food waste, food lots issues and things like that. That's the that milieu, that's the context in which we're thinking of big data. The opportunities in big data. I'd like to encourage you to, if you don't know about this, to go read about the Cochrane collaboration. This comes from the medical community. A guy named Archie Cochrane was a medical doctor in the Second World War. He came back into England after the war, and he is wondering, why is it that we continue to invest all this money on research in the medical area? And we never know about the data that is being generated in different places. We continue to keep doing the same thing over and over again. Brings to mind what Albert Einstein said was the definition of insanity, that is to do something over and over again, expect a different result. And what Archie Cochrane did was to think very differently, bringing all data together to do meta-analysis and make decisions. And a guy named Ian Chalmers is the fellow that started this Cochrane collaboration. And there are some lessons learned for you and I in the agricultural community from what the medical community has done in big data, in meta-analysis, and things like that. Okay? And really, the opportunities are multifold in regards to the evidence-based tools that we can get from open data, big data, in regards to sustainable development and the economic opportunities for our farmers and for the health of our consumers as well. And the second aspect of this is that the open access to research and meta-analysis and the publication of data is really about, time's up already, all right. I'm gonna go for one more minute if you don't mind. Is, at the end of the day, is that about that nutritional security itself that we need to be thinking about. Now obviously, with every opportunity, you gotta whole bunch of attendant challenges as well. And those challenges, you know, everything from ownership. In fact, when Monsanto came out with their field scripts, a lot of farmers got really worried as to who owns these data. And there is, I can tell you, some small effort to try to address these. There's this OATS effort, Open Ag Technology Systems, that is a partnership between academia and the private sector and the non-governmental sector. The Farm Bureau, for example, Mary Kay is gonna be talking about Farm Bureau's perspective on big data as well. And these have all been brought together. Purdue University has taken the lead on helping develop these. And in regards to curation, the disambiguation and the cybersecurity, and who pays for all this? The Deputy Prime Minister in his former life, who pays for this? Is the public gonna pay for it? Is Monsanto gonna pay for it? Is Apple gonna pay for it? Is IBM gonna pay for it? Those are the decisions that we've not made. But the public has a critical role to play in this, and if the public is investing, how does the public own this? How do you figure this out? That's something that we need to address now, not later on. And USDA, of course, has been, you know, doing a lot of these things. We received a circular from the Office of Management and Budget, which is part of the U.S. government, and from the Office of Science and Technology Policy, the President's Advisory Group. So they sent us these directives saying that we have to take USDA-funded and U.S. government-funded data and put it out in the public domain. There's a directive, and we're all working to make that happen, and already we've developed a policy, we're providing access to data, there's greater levels of collaboration and cooperation, and the ultimate aim is to minimize the duplication itself. And along with that, there's this international effort, the Global Open Data in Agriculture and Nutrition effort that's going on as well. Again, the intent is to create this collaborative environment. The intent is to reduce duplication. That's the idea behind this, that brings together this private and public partners all working together to help drive the opportunities afforded us by big data. And I'm gonna skip that. And so really, that nutritional security that I was referring to, that existential threat, is going to be tremendously enabled, and our ability to deal with it, or to solve it, by what big data is gonna allow us to do. And I'm gonna skip this and go to this. I think what happens with all of us is we get hung up on all these gee whiz gizmos, and you know, I'm gonna walk around with my handheld devices and all these sensors, blah, 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 blah. At the end of the day, it's humans that make decisions. And we have to make sure that whatever big data we've got, we bring humans along as well. Otherwise, we're going to set ourselves up for some very significant failures and will not realize the potential that big data offers us if we don't worry about humans. Thank you very much.
Well, Sonny, thank you very much indeed. I think you'd all agree that was an utterly brilliant introduction to the issues that we're going to be thinking about today and the areas which need addressing. Of course, there's an elephant in the room, isn't there? If we are to cope with these enormous challenges, we need societies that can work together so that they make rational decisions. That involves leadership that is able, by dint of its own qualities, by dint of its credibility, by dint of its intellectual and other leadership, to command the respect of people who are going to have to make major decisions, even major life changes, if we're to secure nutritional security for the world's population by 2050, roughly a doubling of food production in very short order. That's a major challenge because, you see, governments everywhere are losing their way, particularly post-GFC. Uncertainty reigns, and cynicism in the community is the result. The man I'm about to introduce, I think, I can say this to you, is an antidote to that sort of cynicism. We need quality leadership. Oz Guinness, an American writer, commented that there is no major challenge confronting the United States that could not be dealt with if we were to engage in a civil debate. We have simply got to learn to drop the emotion, the name-calling, the irrationalism that passes for public debate today. And in the old Voltairean adage, it wasn't Voltaire who said it, it was his biographer, but it's usually he who's attributed to, I may disagree with you, but I will defend to the death your right to say it. You've heard that? It implies two great things. Firstly, the other person has a right to put a point of view, and you're wise to let him put it on the table, him or her put it on the table. Secondly, the idea is the issue, not the other person. I think you all know what I'm driving at. Angus Taylor is a member for Hume. We didn't overlap. He's a very bright bloke. He's a Rhodes Scholar. He must be bright. I think they're still bright at Oxford, aren't they? You've got to be bright to get in there and get through. I think they are. I can say that about him because he's grounded enough not to let it go to his head. You know, he'll sort of enjoy it but not inhale it. He is precisely, I want to say this to you with a note of sincerity and concern, the sort of person we want to be getting behind and encouraging. We need more Angus Taylors if we are to create the political stability and leadership in these uncertain times that lets us secure the policy outcomes that are going to be required to deal with this mass of issues before us. Angus.
Thanks, John. Thanks for that very kind introduction. Yeah, it did strike me. I've never been asked that famous question about inhaling versus enjoying, but no doubt it will come one day. But look, it is a great pleasure to spend a few minutes talking to you here today. I thought I'd just speak for 10 minutes or so and then have some questions and discussion. Sometimes you get more out of that than just speaking. But for me, this is an issue that is an intersection of a number of my passions and experiences over my career. I've had an unusual career in a sense. Prior to politics, I had very little involvement. I was never a staffer before I got into politics and relatively little direct involvement in political parties and so on. But my career spanned both agriculture and business and the two intersect, and I'll talk about that in a moment. But I worked for a number of years as a management consultant, first at McKinsey, then an offshoot of McKinsey, Port Jackson Partners. Much of my work was in commodities. Like a good farm boy, I was brought up on a farm. I kept getting drawn back to those industries, which are the great industries, I believe, of this country. And they have been the dominant part of our exports and our success over several hundred years now. So that has been a fundamental part of my career. But being brought up on a farm just south of here meant that I always had a passion for agriculture and I kept getting drawn back to that. In fact, I went back to the farm for a little while and had the mandatory fallout with Dad, which meant it wasn't going to be sustainable, so off I went again. Lots of people went through that experience. Don't know if you had that experience, John, but it was pretty common amongst my age group. And with three brothers, we had to be pretty innovative. Four boys, we had to be pretty innovative in how we've thought about agriculture, and we have done a number of things that are quite unusual. Some of it's worked, some of it hasn't. But it's meant that we've had to push the envelope right through. And that intersection between my management consulting background and agriculture has meant that I've thought probably longer and deeper than many, perhaps not all, about issues like the ones that you're talking about here today. One of the most exciting pieces of work I've done in my career was when I did manage to get those two worlds that I'd lived in for so many years to collide, when I convinced the ANZ Bank to let me write spend the best part of a year working on a report about the future of agriculture. I don't get the royalties from this, but I'd still love you all to read. It's called Greener Pastures. It was written about, we published about 4 years ago now. And it was on the back of some work that I had been doing in the mining industry since about 2005, where one of the big miners asked me in 2005 and said, you know, we seem to be selling a lot of iron ore to China. Can you just help us think about what's going on here? And of course, some very, very simple work showed that what was happening here was not a short-term aberration. It was a very, very profound change, not just in the iron ore industry, but in the world. That led them on a growth path, a pretty aggressive growth path for the subsequent 10 years or so. But it had always struck me that thinking we did when we first thought about iron ore back, it was probably about 2004, would be really very relevant in agriculture. And I got the opportunity to do this, to think about this, as I say, 5 years ago or so. And we looked at how the changing nature of the world was going to impact agriculture for many decades to come, particularly for Australia and New Zealand. And the striking part of the story, of course, that you've heard just a moment ago, and you'll hear many times again, and I'm sure you've all heard in other forums, is the demand growth side of this story. And people talk about population growth, and that's about a third of it. The more interesting bit is growth in wealth. The much more interesting bit is growth in wealth. Population growth is about 1%. You can expect underlying demand growth for the products of land and water of about 1%. But wealth is responsible for about double that. And that comes in two ways. One is we eat more. It's not always good, but we do eat more as we get wealthier. But the second is that we eat better food. And better food means, ultimately, at its most basic level, it means less carbohydrate, more protein, oil, sugars, fruit and veg. And the thing about that is, whilst that's good for our health, that's actually, you know, we get the food pyramid and all those wonderful things, the demand on land and water is enormous. And I agree with what we just heard, which is we've got a big challenge. Now, I'm actually pretty optimistic about how we can deal with that. But what I do know is that you can be absolutely sure we won't deal with it without big productivity gains. If you add up the numbers, I have the view that 2.5 to 3% demand growth is probably closer to the mark than some others who are perhaps a little lower than that. But it doesn't really matter. What we know is productivity in agriculture in the world is now down to about 1%. It's been falling since the Green Revolution. And if we don't address that issue, we have a big problem. Now, for any commercial person, this is a huge opportunity. You know, you can think of it as a threat. I actually think largely it's an opportunity. And certainly for Australian agriculture, it's a huge opportunity. Because if we can get those productivity levels up, it will have an enormous, enormous impact. Now, this is where I think technology has a huge role to play. And I was supposed to talk here about how we prepare Australia for the future of digital agriculture. Well, from my perspective, digital agriculture is already here. And it's been here for a while. It's growing. Obviously, there's a long, long way to go in this journey. But there is far more going on in digital agriculture than anyone realises. You know, years ago, I actually had a crack at this and was coding and developing software. And I'll tell you a little bit about some of the implications of that from my own thinking in a moment. But, you know, whether it's in cropping, we see precision agriculture, which, you know, only 15 years ago was a dream. Every farmer told you there was no overlap in the way they used you know, the way they got around their paddocks. They didn't use too much fertiliser, they didn't use too much chemical, but the truth was, as GPS emerged, there were huge productivity gains to be made in the way we cropped. If you look at livestock genetics, my own family, we have always done our breeding. Traditionally, we were Merino sheep. Was always by the numbers and always using good CSIRO data that had been around for a long time. We had fantastic research. You know, we were very analytical, driven by the numbers, and it's worked. It's worked. We know our genetics produces about 20% more revenue per sheep than you typically see. Yeah. This is data in agriculture. Dairying, you know, I worked over in the New Zealand dairy industry putting together Fonterra in the 90s, and you know, the way dairy is blessed with extraordinary data, because they can see how much milk each cow produces each day, and that's a huge gift. It's a massive gift. It's not always well used, but it's a huge gift. And again, the better farmers are using this data now for breeding, for production, and we've got to pursue that further. And of course, in irrigation, you know, when I first started getting involved in irrigation agriculture, probably about 12 or 13 years ago, and I saw how people were starting to use soil moisture probes and the data that was coming out of those probes. A lot of this was technology developed in Israel. Extraordinary stuff, which again, I believe has got a lot further to go. In plant genetics, you mentioned cotton growing earlier, and the pace at which yields have grown in cotton is just absolutely mind-boggling. I can't get my head around how quickly this is happening. You know, if you go down to southern New South Wales now, they're producing cotton with yields that were just unimaginable a few years back, and in the north, of course, it's the same. Again, it's all data-driven. This is big data in agriculture. So it's not about our digital future, just about our digital future. It's also about the digital present. We're actually doing a lot in this space, and we need to capitalise on that. Now, the big question is, what have we got to get right to make the most of this in the coming years and deliver to that 2-3% productivity goal that I think is the sort of space we should be shooting into? And what's the role of government? It's pretty clear to me that we still need an enormous amount of innovation. And we're great innovators in Australia, but we have a problem in our innovation system. I may not be popular in saying this, but the truth is that Australian science and innovation has been very, very good at the more fundamental level and in terms of public funding. If you look at our public funding levels, and I'm sure there'll be scientists here, we'll say we need more. But the truth is, relative to other countries, give or take, we're not a mile out. About 2% of GDP. Where we absolutely get it wrong is private sector investment. Our venture capital, I was sitting last night with Startup Australia. We have a problem. We have a serious, serious problem in the private sector part of our innovation system. You know, we should be producing the best software, the best hardware in agricultural, big data agriculture, but we're not. Yes, there's some great stuff going on, but we are not leading the world in the way that I think we should be. And a lot of this comes down to the way we commercialised incredible research which comes out of our publicly funded researchers in this country, but we haven't been good at taking it out to market. So the innovation side of this is incredibly important. The infrastructure side, I'm sure, will get lots of focus. And you will see an announcement today, mid-morning today, about mobile phone towers being rolled out across rural Australia. It's a stunning announcement. It's way beyond my expectations. It's very, very exciting. But that to me is just part of it. We've also got a very strong focus in the NBN rollout now on rural Australia, and as it should be, because the fundamental problem with the internet in this country isn't in the cities, it's in rural areas. And that's where it always should have been focused. That's where it always should have been focused, and that's actually where the focus is going to now. Now, I'm going to say something a little bit provocative here, which is the problem here, I think, fundamentally, is not so much rolling out towers. That's part of it. The fundamental problem we've got in rural telecommunications is how we get the data from the farm or the town back to the data centre. It's the back, what the information technology industry will describe as the backhaul. It's the highways back to the centres. If we had open access backhaul in this country, if we had the ability to move that data back, we would have towers spring up all over rural Australia tomorrow. People know how to do it. And this is the problem we are realising now. What you will see later on today is I think, doing some good work in heading in this direction. But this is the fundamental policy problem that I think we ultimately have to solve. If you go to the UK, there are competing backhaul networks, and it means that there is much more competition out in rural areas. And this is something I think we're going to have to address. So the final area that I just wanted to mention, where I think government has a big role to play, is on the people side. And one of the real problems with digital agriculture is uptake. You can have the best product imaginable. But, as companies like Monsanto, who rolled out, minimum till years ago, found it took them about 3 goes to get it to work. And it wasn't because the technology wasn't working, it's because they couldn't get the people's side right. How we actually sell this technology, how we train people, how we educate people to use it is extremely important. Farmers are great innovators, but you have to get the whole system behind a new technology for it to work. That means the consultants, the accountants, as well as the farmers themselves, all of the advisors, as well as the farmers themselves. And that education side is extremely, extremely important, and you'll hear more about this in the coming weeks and months as well. So there's some really key areas, I think, for us to focus on. I think this is an area that it will have a big impact in the years to come. I'm certainly passionate about making sure that we do have an impact in this area, and I wish you luck throughout the rest of today. I don't know if we've got time for questions, John. How are we going for time?
If Angus has a moment, just until he has to go, I would invite questions to him. The rule, by the way, for the panel sessions today is that if you don't know the answer or you don't want to answer it, I'll flick it to Graham Blight, all right? In 30 years, Graham, I've never known you lost for an answer. Not once. Questions to Angus. Sir.
Angus, I was very, very impressed about the mobile phone tower, right?
Yep.
That's exactly what we need. Now, the next thing is IPv6. Can the government sort of push that along a bit, because it's fundamental to big data and the Internet of Things?
Yeah, I understand. Look, I'm not close to that, and I'll have to take that question on notice, and I understand the issue. We were actually talking about it a couple of weeks ago. What I don't know is where we're at on that issue, but I appreciate the question, and it's certainly one I can take on notice.
Can you manage one more? I know you've got to move off very soon. Looks like you've satisfied them, Angus. No? Thank you very much indeed.
Thanks, John.
All the best. Well, that was tremendous, and I think reassuring for those of us who like to know that people are going into the Parliament who have their minds around the relevant issues, are able to take it forward, and have about them the personal qualities that might encourage people to debate, as I said earlier, the issues rather than the personalities. It's my pleasure now to introduce Dr. Brian Keating, the Executive Director of Agriculture, Food and Health at the CSIRO. Brian, again, we have your CV, so I won't waste time. It's terrific to have you, and welcome to the stage.
Thank you, John, and good morning, everyone. Okay, look, my talk wasn't choreographed with the two you've heard already, but many of the threads have been picked up. So I'll go through pretty quickly, so bear with me, but maybe we can draw a few of those threads together. I can see down here. We live in some pretty interesting times, and many of these forces have already been commented on. We live in a hungrier world, a wealthier world, a world that's got some challenges, a bumpier ride, if you like, a world where people have higher expectations, for life, for what they eat, how they live, and a world where some stunning technologies are transforming industries and the way we live every day. I always like to look back as we look forward. It's always good to see where we've come from. And so if we look back to the big agriculture story of the 20th century, the world population doubled, but our food production rose by much more than that. In fact, per capita food production rose by 20%. The yields around the world more than doubled, and we're able to feed that much bigger world with only 8% more land that went under cultivation. And of course, lots of inputs were required to achieve all that. But all of that required three big things: great science and technology, leadership from governments and institutions around the world, and innovation from businesses and farmers. And of course, that became known as the Green Revolution. And if you look at it over a very, very long time frame, here's about 500 years, you see that kick up. That's what the Green Revolution had to meet. That's the food demand curve. And we take that forward a little bit, and we see we've got to do that again in this century. And so if we take that bit, that blue triangle or wedge is the extra food production that's needed over the next 40 or so years. We can think of how that's going to be met in three ways. We've already heard about issues like waste from Sunny. Clearly, there's a lot we can do to reduce that demand curve. There's still going to be a lot of the gap to be filled by lifting productivity and production. So technology from science is still going to be important. But there's a wedge here that often gets forgotten, that if we sort of stop doing things, if we stop investing in science, if we don't look after the land and the soils and the water, if we don't tackle things like climate change, then we're going to go backwards. And so there's an extra challenge there of sustaining productive capacity. So looking forward, they're the sorts of wedges, the sorts of pathways whereby these challenges will be met. And I'm an optimist as well on this, but it won't happen by doing nothing. The soils issues that we're on about today are very critical in those, particularly in those two pathways flagged there. And of course, Australia's got its own agricultural successes. From about the 1950s to 2000, we more or less doubled wheat yields across the country through lots of transformations in technologies and genetics and soil management was pretty important, a lot of that. And we also sit now in a sea of great opportunity. The market prospects for Australian agriculture are very strong. This is ABARES work on the prospects of a doubling of our commodity exports by 2050. So we've got that sort of positive trajectory going forward. And one of the reasons for that, this is just for China, look at what's happening in China food imports. This is a fairly recent phenomenon. This is the last decade that this is going on, and China's just one country to the north of us. So 2 billion emerging middle-class consumers to the north of us. So that's obviously a very big positive driver for Australian agriculture. But we can't just assume that's an easy ride for Australia, that we don't need to lift our game. Look what Brazil's done in the last decade or two. They've tripled their agricultural exports. And of course, they're going to be meeting those markets as well. This slide is a cause for concern. So this is our total factor productivity for different sectors. We heard about the 2 or 3% annual rates of growth in productivity through the latter part of last century. And it's difficult to unpack this because we've had a lot of droughts and a lot of difficult years in the first decade of this century. But there's a pretty clear signal that our Our rates of productivity growth have leveled off a little, or eased off a little, and they're closer to the 1% now than the 2 or 3 that we might like to see. And as Paul Krugman, the Nobel Prize winning economist, said, productivity isn't everything, but in the long run, it's almost everything. So that's a challenge for us. I also like to look back at where the soil's history has come from here. And I dug out this report. This is the first report of Australia's agricultural research. It comes from a predecessor of my organisation, CSIRO. Before CSIR started in 1926, there was an organisation called the Advisory Council of Science and Industry. It was chaired by the Prime Minister, Billy Hughes, I think, at the time. This meeting was run in 1917. And it was the first national meeting of agricultural research in Australia. It makes fascinating reading. And they're the good gentlemen. They're all gentlemen, obviously, at the time, who attended this meeting in Melbourne in November 1917. If you think about what was happening in 1917, it's just amazing to look through this report. In fact, the Prime Minister's presence was delayed by the War Cabinet meeting, and so heady days. But this gentleman was there, and I pulled out a quote from him. He was the first professor of agriculture from the University of Sydney. So he's relevant to today's meeting. And he made the comment, it seems to me we should make a start with a problem which will take many, many years, perhaps centuries, to complete, namely the making of a soil survey for the continent. So. And he's right, we're still working on it, and it is a century later. So let's honour him. That's Professor R.D. Watt. Is it? Alex knows. Robert Dickey Watt. Professor Robert Dickey Watt. 100 years since he made that commentary. And so we're still working on it for him. In fact, we are still working on it. Much of last century, a lot of the debate was around different soil classification schemes. Over the years, it moved towards trying to create a national integrated framework so all of our soils information could be coherent and collected in a sort of a national setting. So the Australian Collaborative Land Evaluation Program has been quite successful in doing that. All of the states and the Commonwealth agencies involved have worked together pretty hard over recent years. And increasingly, the focus has moved towards using that information in smarter ways, not just being happy to classify soils because they're there, but to collect the sort of data, the sort of soils data that can be really useful for a farmer who wants to know something about soil water, or a planning agency that wants to know whether there's agricultural potential in some particular part of the country. These are some of the sort of things that grew out of that that my own team have been involved in over the years. These are all tools which are fed by soil data. They need soil data, but they actually convert it into things that are meaningful for farming or planning or policy. And here's an example, mapping the prospects to lift wheat yields. This is on a regional basis, and areas to the west of us here, to the north of us, here. So those different colours refer to wheat yield prospects, the sort of the level of wheat yields being achieved relative to what's possible. These are called yield gaps. So it might be surprising that even today there's still significant yield gaps in Australia's wheat farming areas. Many regions are running at 50 to 60% of what's technically possible. Running at 100% is probably impossible. That's too risky because we're trying to manage this against the climate. But this sort of work can be brought right down to the farm level to help farmers benchmark their yield performance and to interpret the reasons for falling below the threshold, the frontiers, and to navigate their way towards lifting those yields towards the technical possibilities. A different type of application for soil data. This is recent work on topical at the moment on exploring the agricultural feasibility in Northern Australia. So that's new land resource and soil mapping happening in the Gulf Country. That's in the Flinders River catchment, and of course that is used to assess the feasibility of new agricultural investments and water infrastructure and so on. And a lot of this then comes together in a thing called the Soil and Landscape Grid of Australia. So this is the platform where all of our soil relevant information needs to come together in a connected way. It's about consistency, reliability, functionality, and a comprehensive approach, and has a range of applications. And the point here is this requires everyone. They're some of the organisations that are working to bring this together. It requires everyone to work together in a coordinated, collaborative way. All the state agencies, the universities, CSIRO, plus important investment from the Commonwealth Government in things like the National Collaborative Research Infrastructure Scheme, NCRIS. And of course, TERN, the Terrestrial Ecosystems Research Network, is an NCRIS facility. Okay. So, joining the dots, how am I going on time? Right? Joining the dots. Angus Taylor said digital agriculture is here today, and I think I'd agree with him. Let's unpack it. Sonny put a big list of all those things that are part of digital agriculture, didn't she? Or big data. Hundreds of things, but I actually think they come down to three categories. It's really about gathering information of some sort, interpreting that information, and that interpretation is for some particular purpose, and then taking some action. So at its core, it's about improved decision making off the back of better use of information, interpretive tools. They might be models, or they might be all sorts of things. And of course, various actions. And they might be robotics or automation or precision agriculture or whatever, many, many dimensions. But some of the complexity here, I think you can cut through by saying, well, show me what the improved decision-making environment is that we're talking about, and how this data infrastructure might flow through to that. Some of that improved decision making is at a farmer level. Some of it's at the level of national governments who have to plan infrastructure investments or explore feasibilities of different policy outcomes. So, and I think we've heard some of this cautionary note already this morning as well. So data confidentiality, data ownership and control, the complexity of the systems and the incompatibility of systems, and the fact that farming is a human business. It's a people business. It's not, I doubt many farmers went farming because they want to be some, you know, a circuit board on a computer chip or something, you know, so it's essentially a human business and will stay that way. Doesn't mean that technology can't be really quite embraced and transformational, but if we ignore the fact it's a human business, we'll have those failures that I think you might have mentioned, Sonny. And so I think the social and institutional challenges here are likely to be at least as significant, or perhaps more significant, than the technical challenges that are certainly still there, but many of those are being knocked over. And I just wanted to finish on this slide that we do here recently have got our national soil RD&E plan as a national collaborative plan. All the Commonwealth State University and industry agencies interested in this matter have contributed to this plan. I think it's going to remain, it needs to remain central going forward, because many of the challenges I've talked about, those social and institutional ones, as well as the data coherence and consistency, they all require a degree of collaboration and coordination. And this is the, I think, the best platform we've got that's got the Australian government support. It's got the support of the rural development corporations, all the agencies in universities and CSRO, and as well as state governments. So I just flag that now as something that we can build on to get the collaborative and cooperative parts of this this all working going forward. So thank you for that.
Brian, if you would not leave, I'm going to ask Sonny to join you. Take a seat here each. We've got just a few minutes for your questions, and then we have a short break before we move to the next hall to listen to Barnaby Joyce.
You want to sit here and I'll sit there?
No, I'm quite happy to sit out on the right. That seems to be my natural place. who'd like to get the ball rolling? Sir, down there. I can't see against the light, and I don't know who you are, so would you just say who you are briefly and who you represent?
Good morning. My name's Paul Vervell. I'm from the Australian National University. Firstly, thank you very much to both of the presenters for really great presentations. I wanted to pick up a couple of the key points that you made in your presentations. One was the perfect storm of pressures around rising food demand, population income growth, and also shocks like climate change, and and how that they will affect food production going forward, and also the water, energy, and environmental resources which food production, greatly expanded food production, will depend upon and also affect. As Andrea mentioned in the introductory remarks, maybe one of the endpoints for better data management is really having better and more efficient resource management. So my question is, what do you see are really the key gaps between better and more data on the one hand, and then improved decision making around sustainable food production at both the farm level and also government policy as well? Thank you.
Okay. You want to go first?
Sure. Okay. Well, Paul, thanks very much for that question. And I think, you know, in regards to the gaps that we've got, there is this chasm between the groups that are actually generating the data and all the science that's behind it and all the gizmos that are behind it and the end users and the policies and so on. There is a huge chasm between those. That gap needs to be bridged first. And I think that's where the challenge is that we've got, is that there is a disconnect between the scientists and the folks that do the policy making and actually developing the tools and things like that too. And so the comments that that John made and Angus made and Brian made as well in regards to those collaborations that we need, bringing these different disparate groups together to help, you know, bridge that gap is I think the place where we're gonna have the greatest opportunities right now.
Yeah, and I'd support that and just add, I think the sort of, I think the private data interest, confidentiality, I think can be managed technically, but the sort of the ownership issues is a big one. The public data access, the open data stuff is easy enough and is heading that way in this country as well, is what you've said in the US. But I think we need some form of cooperative structure so that farmers and private data holders can contribute that data into environments where they're like win-win environments where they know they're going to get some value back, but they're not losing control of that data. Their confidentiality is maintained as well. So it's It's been put to me that it's a bit like the cooperative problem in rural industries. Cooperatives emerged, you know, whether it was for marketing or whatever, because there were private interests and collective interests, and the cooperative structure emerged as a way of managing both the private and the collective interest in a structured way. And I think there's a sort of a cooperative data exchange need emerging in for our rural industries that we've got to think through issues like, you know, how do we pay for that? Who manages it? How do we build trust in that? What's the role of public institutions? What's the role of industry institutions in getting that sort of cooperative framing? And it's relevant to both, you know, productivity, profitability issues, as well as the resource management and fundamental land and landscape integrity issues, which I think you frame your question around as well.
Just a comment, it may be a role, or there may be a place for better coordination between the key decision makers in government. And I know Mike Jeffries is very interested in this area of whether or not the government portfolios unnecessarily silo the disciplines that often need better coordination. Might be a question that you'd like to store up in mind, a question or two for Barnaby Joyce later as well. Yeah. Another question before we have a break and then move on. Sir, just here. Right, yep.
Tony Hill from Capitol Hill Consulting. I think you've painted a great picture between the three speakers this morning of what the future can be. I'm interested if you could just drill down a bit more, extending your last answer, to say who you think the major investors in making a big data future might happen in Australia. And I guess drawing some comparisons between whether they're kind of large corporate investors versus a multiplicity of smaller investors in individual farms, and I guess then you go on to the extent to which government needs to play a role.
Thanks, Tony. Look, I think there's reasons for all of that list to benefit, and hence the reasons for them all to invest. It's just that and there are some elements of that which are need to be highly collectivised, and some that are more privatised. So I think it's about how that whole information architecture is designed, so that the big private sector companies that have been quite at the forefront of this, that there's definitely a place for them in that. They need to access the public data as well, and there'll be commercial relationships where that they're involved in that will be more private. So I see that it's about almost designing the architecture of that. The different investments and interests are sort of there already, but it's just not the pieces of the jigsaw are there, but the picture hasn't been put together, how it might fit together.
So if I might add from my perspective, you know, from the United States' perspective, and there may be some lessons learned as well, and in fact, you know, Angus Taylor was referring to it in his comments that he made, that creating the environment in which the private investors find opportunities. I think in my own case, for example, in the last 12 months, I've had more venture capitalists contact me, you know, I work for the federal government in the United States, contact me about opportunities. And in this entire space, you know, that supply chain that I was referring to, from the farm to the dinner table. But really it takes creating that environment where the private investors do see value. But the public has a very significant role to play in this as well. And that's going to be very critical for the Australian situation, is that you don't have these impediments that prevents private enterprise from coming and seeing that they can capitalize. You know, they make the necessary investments and capitalize as well. Very critically important to create that sort of a framework. And I think that's what Brian's been referring to.
And can I add as well that we shouldn't think in agriculture or rural industry we have to completely invent all this ourselves. There is other sectors that are going through the same thing. I'd be looking to health right now as to the forces that some of the same forces that are shaping health data and health information for public benefit and private benefit are relevant lessons, I think, for agriculture.
Sure. It might be interesting to contemplate. We've got a furious debate going on in Australia about housing affordability, particularly in New South Wales. There's a pretty powerful argument to be mounted in this case that one of the reasons it's so hard to attract capital to venture actually lies in the tax system. Mm. It's skewed in favour, to be blunt, of housing. And that, so people pile their money into housing to an extent often that, frankly, is not altogether responsible. See, I can say all sorts of things now that I'm not in the Parliament. there's a powerful argument to be mounted, by, and I think is by some thinking economists, that it's a significant distortion that creates problems in the very areas that we're talking about. Something as basic as how we're going to feed people in the future. I think we've got time for one more brief one, if you promise me. Not wanting to be a dictator today, but we'll move ballrooms quickly after this. Right down the back. And then we're going to take, I'll give you a few minutes break to finish your breakfast and coffee, and we've got to move ballrooms.
Richard Heath, University of Sydney. Angus Taylor made the point that digital agriculture has been around a while. Before I was in this role, I was a farmer myself for 20 years, quite close to John's farm on the Liverpool Plains.
He was a good farmer too.
Oh, hopefully I still am, John. But
that should be a relief to the university.
The technology, it's beyond proof of concept. It's there. The one of the biggest gaps that I see is the human aspect that we've all the speakers have touched on. What's been slowly driving better and better implementation is as the technology gets more embedded in everything that we do. So you buy a tractor, it comes with the ability to collect data. It's not something you have to add on anymore. So there's two ways that we can sort of get to that final step of implementation of using all these technologies. We can either just wait until it gets, that there's a market solution that just makes it simpler and simpler and simpler, so that the skill base doesn't have to change that much in the farming community to start using all of this, or we can have a dedicated effort to change the skill base and upskill farmers to appreciate the technology and start using it at a higher level. And I'd just be interested in the opinion of the speakers of you know, particularly in the United States, what you see happening or what you think the quickest way is going to be. Because if we need to upskill the farmer base, I don't see much evidence of that happening through public policy or any other means to sort of recognise that as an issue.
Yeah. Well, so Richard, indeed, you know, in the States, we've got what we refer to as a digital literacy initiative. And the intent behind that is to utilize the in quotes, the offices of our Cooperative Extension Service to be able to provide farmers the help in becoming, in quotes, digitally literate. And this is not just the big farmers, the small farmers as well. So we want, you know, all of agriculture, the participants in it, the producers, to have the necessary skills. That's happening, and at the same time, you know, these groups are also reaching out to the John Deere's and the Monsanto's and others to help, you know, in the sort of the downscaling of that level of capabilities as well. So there's a sort of a convergence coming along here that is a critical part of what you're talking about.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, it's my great pleasure to introduce a man I respect greatly and regard as a personal friend, Barnaby Joyce. He's not quite my member. I'm just 10 k's or so out of his area. But I had the great privilege of serving as his campaign chairman when he took on an interesting task. He is, in fact, to the best of my knowledge, the only Australian who served as a senator in one state and as a member of the House of Representatives in another state. Barnaby Joyce is making his way forward. We're thankful for his time. He's a man of great passion and drive and commitment who believes in making a difference, and I salute him for that. As he comes, I'd make the observation, you know, this is putting in a bit of a plug to a successor, if you like, that in this whole area of the uptake of new technology, of new ideas and what have you, you know, as a farmer, I sometimes know that for all of, you know, our egalitarian instincts and our desire to operate in a free market, sometimes we love a little subsidy. And the little subsidies that went under the banner of Farm Biz, they were part of a package we introduced in 1996-7 called Agriculture Advancing Australia, which had wrapped into it things like farm management deposits and what have you. But it included Farm Biz, which were subsidised training programs. And I was just talking to Terry McCosker here from Queensland, be known to many of you, the uptake of training courses, if you like, professional development by farmers with that little bit of support from the taxpayers, was staggering, and you can track the numbers. They produced great economic outcomes. So there, Barnaby, is just a little plug for a program that I know you are very interested in and supportive of, but it's tremendous to welcome you up here. I promise you, Pistol and Boo are nowhere to be seen. When you're ready, it's over to you.
Hi.
Hi. Good to see you. We're ready when you are.
Okay,
Barnaby, welcome.
Well, thank you very much for that, John, and it's a great pleasure to be here today for the innovation in Australian agriculture and the discussion around soils, around all the things that the variable inputs that are so decisive in how we go. For a long period of time, or actually for 5 years, I worked for a bank, QIDC. And one of my jobs was to go around and put a valuation on people's places. That was part of the role. And of course, everybody believes their place is worth an awful lot of money, and apparently the neighbours is not quite as much. It was always extremely important. You had to keep your wits about you and be discerning and deliberative as to what was the actual fundamental structure of that place. The one thing I can always assure you is trees don't lie. Trees were always a great indicator of the soil structure, of the capacity of the land, and so if you had, you'd always look at things that had been there for 40, 50, 100, 200 years rather than something that they had planted in their garden. And therefore, your strip, especially along the road, was vitally important. It's always been an issue since man's been in agriculture that we understand the component parts. And right back to Roman times, it was De Rustica, they gave the breakdowns of the attributes in agriculture, and that program stood for about 1,000 years. It's always interesting in that sort of assessment. It was given in prose. In that assessment, they went through the deliberative understanding of the different types of soils and came up with some sort of basic concepts, which are still true to today. That is, black soils are predominantly more productive than lighter soils. However, marsh soils are not. They went through the problems. They have high productive soils in Libya, which was a lighter soil, but they found that one of the higher yields they could achieve from that. It was fundamental in actually underpinning the economics, the agroeconomics of the Roman Empire. Even today, we are always at the forefront and trying to be at the cutting edge of our understanding of our component parts. Today, we have started to move in towards silos. We've got red technology and green technology. We are trying to get the technology from our header and apply it back to our planter and our application of DAP, phosphorus, nitrogen, as you wish. But trying to get this information to talk to each other can at times be difficult. We also have within that scheme, Australia is still a manufacturer, especially in farm equipment, and simplicity is one of the probably one of the leading people in farm plants, especially planters, and trying to make sure even today that we have this capacity for one lot of information to talk to the other. Today I'm announcing $1.5 million through the CSIRO so that we can be part of a process of trying to, and of course public money means public information, of better mapping all those details so that we get a better understanding of the component parts in the creation of the Australian, or in the farming of the Australian crop. And Australia has to be at the forefront. We don't have the benefit of the Iowas or the Ukraines. We probably have, I hate to say it because he's in the room, but some of our best soils are on the Liverpool Plains, and John Anderson won't argue with me with that because he owns some of them. But it is away from that, we have more of a more complicated matrix of how we are going to work with it. What we are looking for in this information and this announcement is the capacity to ground source information, obviously the information we all know, such as your soil types and soil structures, To overlay over that, the technology that we now have, especially in satellite componentry, and also to further cross-test that to yields, to give you the capacity of a software system so that and really when you think about it, it's not such a complicated idea of how you can change your inputs and get some sort of greater anticipation of your yield. Now, a lot of you probably already have that in the technology that you run, but this is to try and bring in these disparate parts. I see more and more in our nation that we're having sort of parallel technologies, and I think we've got to really start thinking about how we have the best technology. I think we are starting to see now where the IP is becoming more complex, but it is held in silos. It's held with Case, or it's held with John Deere, or it's held with somebody else. And I think that really we've got to. Probably because I'm affected by cotton farmers, which are one thing I've always known about cotton is people were not jealous about letting other people know how they did their job, and this gave us a greater capacity across the board to get a general advancement. I'm strongly of the belief that if everybody knows what is best, then everybody gets ahead for the betterment of all. In that frame, that is why in cotton we have the highest yields in the world. I think that you look at that, and the IDC at Narrabri has been very good at this, but you look at that because people are not selfish about the information. They see that if there is a proper spread of the information, then everybody benefits. And part of this announcement is to make sure that we draw that information together. It is in the task that we have before us, I suppose it's the world will always, strongly believe, will be able to feed itself. There is no doubt about that. India is a net exporter of food, and it's got a growing population. It's the idea that we will start running out of food is a myth. But the capacity to deliver a quality product is where the trick is in agriculture. I mean that's where the money's to be made. And agriculture so often runs itself down when we're at the cutting edge. But they talk across the nation about productivity gains. We're at the cutting edge of productivity gains. Australian agriculture is one of the best in productivity gains. Once more, referring back to the cotton industry, when I was starting with them, would have been 1994. We had to, in an assessment of a credit paper, give a very good reason as to why someone could do better than, and talking in the imperial measure, 2.7 bales to the acre. That was the magic number. If you were doing better than 2.7, there had to be some exceptional reason. Now, if you did 2.7 bales to the acre, you'd go broke. If you're on irrigated agriculture, that would be hopeless. Now we're seeing 5 bales to the acre, and people are saying, well, that's not that exceptional. That's very, very good, but it's not exceptional. And this is the sense of why is that happening? Well, why it's happening is we're just getting a lot better at our job. A lot better at making sure that the application is appropriate for the area. Knowing the soils and knowing when there is a reason. There's no point going to a poorer, if you've got a larger aggregation, going to a poorer section and thinking that, I just put on more nitrogen, I'm going to get a better yield. No, there's actually a ceiling. You have a certain soil and then you have a certain capacity for that. And there's not really much you can add to it. In fact, in some instances, it's better to add to your better soils because you're going to get a better turnaround than to add to your poorer soils and think magic is going to happen. If magic happened, Australia would be a market garden. So all this technology is part of the componentry parts that we are trying to do in agriculture. As a nation, we should be, and it's you guys who are doing it. So we try to assist in a small way in government, but you guys are doing it. We are having the biggest turnaround in commodity prices in our nation's history, and they're all linked up. If we look at cattle prices, highest prices on record. If we're looking at wool prices, we're getting wool prices back towards record prices. If we've had sheep prices at a record level. On other issues that are away from this, even in some of our fruit markets, blueberries. To think that today I'll announce a mobile phone tower at a little place called Drake. Drake. There's nothing. For years, there was nothing at Drake. There was nothing. Drake was a reason for you to put your foot on the accelerator. That was about it. they said the best view of Drake is the 100 km/h speed limit on the way out. But now there is bound to be about 300 to 400 people working there, in blueberries. A whole new industry. Today we'll put a mobile phone tower in there. That's something, because the demand is so high. Today we are building warehouses in Tenterfield to move this product up, and it's going to also work in with other investments, $200 million in a private in a new airport at Toowoomba for the movement of freight. Today we are living in a different place. Today there is better knowledge, not just of our capacity, of our farming capacity here, but a global knowledge about farming capacity. Recently I had the privilege of going over to Heilongjiang province in China, and Heilongjiang means black dragon, it's the name of the river. And just to see the agricultural capacity there, incredible soils, highly productive area. They, like everybody, are going to become smarter at doing their job, and we'll be competing against them. You go to the Ukraine, obviously, brilliant soils, a bit politically unstable at the moment, but incredible capacity. The world will be producing food, and the world will feed itself. Our advantage is to produce the quality product. Right from Derustica to what we are doing now with satellites is the continual analysis of us being able to understand our componentry parts in agriculture and combine them in such a way that we make sure that we get the best outcome, not just for the agricultural sector, but for our nation. And what we're announcing today, I see, is really, if you could go back to Spain, I think it was Columbus in, was it 4 AD, he kicked off, that if he could understand that what he was doing then in trying to, in his sort of tabulation of the sectors of agriculture and trying to differentiate how in this Roman Empire he was going to try and assist so that we get the best turnaround, and trying to, for his identification of the Libyan soils as opposed to Syrian soils, as opposed to the soils in the Iberian Peninsula. And what we are doing today is still just an extension of that. But now we are using satellites, now we're using ground sourcing, and now we're using yield monitors, but we're trying to do the same outcome. We're trying to get the best bang for our buck with the information that's at our disposal. So that's the announcement there. I'm not going to try and extend myself too much, because I know that I'm surrounded by people who know vastly more than I will ever know, so I'm more in for a wish to absorb rather than to deliberate. So thank you very much. I know that we've got a Q&A session. All the best and God bless.
I think we'd like you up here so we can cross-examine you. I promise we'll be nicer than they will be at 2 o'clock in the house this afternoon. Would you like to take a seat?
Sure.
Who wants to get the ball rolling?
Who wants? Can you hear that? I was out in the little town at the back of your electorate once. No, it's not your electorate. It's Mark Colton's. Garrah. And didn't have a mic. It was a tin hall. I was trying to explain how the proposed 15% GST was going to work, the Houston election. And there's a summer downpour. It's about 8 o'clock in the summer's evening out north of Moree. And tin roof drowned me out, you see. I didn't have a mic. And through the gloom, I could see a bloke down the back. Some wit yelled out, "Hey, that rains. They're 15% on that too." And I was able to say, "No, it's a business input. You get it back." But I could see this bloke down the back, and I said, "Can you still hear me, Jim?" He said, quick as a flash, he said, "I can." He said, "But in view of what you're telling me, I'd like to change places with someone who can't." Who wants to open the batting? Sir, I can't see you against the light. You'll have to, if you could just say who you are, and Barnaby, so that you know he's not from the, no, I won't say the ALP.
Minister, my name's Peter McInerney. I'm from Wagga. One of our biggest problems is bandwidth, and you mentioned this place called Drake. The NBN doesn't seem to be much of an answer at the moment. We've been capacity constrained for 20 years with data and information flow. Can you have a word with your mate Malcolm and see if he can put up an extra satellite or two, please?
Well, thanks for that, Peter. There's nothing better than doing this. I'll do that and I'll get back to you this afternoon and we'll see what we can do because we're putting up two. And it is important, obviously now, I was fascinated. I've got a good mate called John Travis and we were sitting down and he was telling me now how if a bearing starts going on, he works with John Deere, bearing starts going on a tractor around St. George, they have their own base station. The information of the computer is relayed to the base station, sent to a satellite, sent to Detroit. Detroit send the information back to St. George and they ring up and say, you now have a $5,000 problem and if you keep driving, it's going to be a $50,000 problem, so stop. That's incredible. That is happening right now. Now, so we have to have better mobile capacity, better bandwidth, and it is actually driving this NBN technology onto the farm. It is important for us. I'll let you into a secret. Today I'll announce 28 new mobile phone black spots in New England. Don't worry about it.
I'm only 10 k's away.
And we are getting, and I look at my own system, I get 37 megabit downloaded from the NBN, but we do have areas which we can't get. So we're putting up two satellites. We have to actually buy the slots. You have to book your slots. It's so crowded up there now. You can't just chuck a satellite up because it'll run to another one. And it's like it's like that movie or whatever it is, Gravity. So these things, I think we're sending up one in August and then we're sending up one next year. And that becomes part of our delivery on a wider reach, Peter, to areas such as yours. And we'll just keep driving this agenda out, driving out the NBN, driving up more mobile phone areas, because it is, especially in farming, it's going to be the way things work.
Well, take that as a Dorothy Dixer, which is often how you get more information than a hostile question. Next. Here's your opportunity.
Nothing better than that.
Sir. You all right?
And I'd like to congratulate you for moving the agricultural office to Armidale. I think it's a great move with the smart farm. Now, my question to you is this big data thing is quite complex, especially for farmers. What sort of project would you like to see from big data that could actually help our farmers internationally? Are there any particular projects you'd envisage we could work on?
Alan, and I also commend the work that if anybody ever gets a chance to go up to the smart farm at Armidale is quite something. It's almost avant-garde, but there's some great ideas there. And just I'll also touch base with something else you said. I want to decentralise as much as possible. I really want to create centres of excellence in agriculture. I think it's incredibly important for our nation, so we have got a push of trying to get RDCs and APVMO better co-located with areas that I think that they can sort of, over the long term, over the decades, become a more stringent and sort of delivery of an outcome, and also living in an area where they're actually dealing with their users, with their closer to the farmers, to be honest. The question you asked then, Alan, was, what with big data, what can we what do we make it our target? I find that really, you never really know, Alan, until you sort of get there. It's hard to sort of predict. One of the classic examples is almost like water technology. If you build a dam for a certain purpose, the only thing you'll be certain about is that the purpose will change. It's just making sure that you've got the infrastructure in place. Using St. George as an analogy. At the start, they built Beardmore Dam, small dam for fat lamb production, apparently what it was for. No fat lambs there now, but there's about $1 billion a year or plus $1 billion a year cotton industry. And so you can't really reach forward and determine what you're going to do. You just try, Alan, to get your basics right. And so for this process is, what are our basics and are undeniable and unchangeable? Soil structure, predominantly climatic variation, but we know the range we'll be working in. Like, it's not going to turn into a rainforest or hopefully not a desert. So we've got a pretty, try and narrow down that ranges, trying to give us a better reach forward, and we'll do this in the white paper, a better reach forward of understanding, see if we can get more precise understanding of where we'll be in the next 3-4 months. I think that's going to be incredibly important in crop production. But I don't have any sort of grand vista of we will produce, you know, a higher premium wheat or something like that. I'll let the farmers do that. But what I'll try and do is be part of making sure that all the information they get is as concise and appropriate, and to be honest, freely available. I worry a bit about this sort of, Alan, this creation of silos for information. It's like patenting the human genome. It worries me. I think that this information is there for all to use, and the technology should be how smart you use that information, not you precluding other people from getting access to that information.
Lady down here on the table 3N.
Hi, Barnaby. It's Meg Cumro here from the Grains Research Foundation in Queensland. Firstly, I'd like to say I think Bongeen possibly has better soils than the Liverpool Plains, and I hope we're getting a new tower. Capacity building of growers is something that's very close to the GRF's heart, and the conversation surrounding big data and innovation in agriculture is one of the hot topics. How do you see is the best way forward for capacity building for growers so that they can best make use of this data?
Obviously the GRDC has a role to play there as well. I think we're doing it today. I mean, part of this announcement today is to make sure that we create a public capacity to get access to vital information that helps them do a better job. Capacity building I'll be more succinct. When we won the election, when we got back, our budget in agriculture was decimated. Well, less than half of what it was when John Howard and John Anderson left. So I understand perfectly. We have got to get that extension capacity out, that extension officer out, so that we get the technology from the smart farm at UNE being actually delivered for what they're available to do in on the property. To go from Curtin University and the investments we've made there into grain research, in excess of $100 million investment about a year ago now. It's all very well people sitting in lab coats and doing marvellous work, but unless it actually ends up back in the paddock, it's esoteric. And so I have to, and between the state governments, the GRDCs, the Commonwealth, we have to start reinvesting in extension officers and that competency skill. It's there in agronomists are doing a good job of it at a private level, and that's part of the answer. But I think we have to create a greater connection between the work that we are doing at Curtin, the work they're doing at UNE, their work there. We've just put on, I think it was 8 new PhD students at Toowoomba, or might be more. We made an investment there to try and sort of progress that, but get that information out. I think the farmers now are naturally getting bigger. That's just been a progression over time. So farmers now, I feel, on all forms, are a lot more astute in accessing the information themselves. You're finding obviously vastly more now have tertiary qualifications by the time they get back home, or if they haven't, they've had a much greater sort of extensive education even at secondary school. The extension also, and trying to get this culture of getting agriculture back in at the ground level from year 7 on, and having people understand that this is a really serious and exciting place to be, And that's probably one of the also reasons I'm trying to, on your behalf, to create these centres of excellence so that you have that that sort of line of vision between the secondary student, the tertiary student, to the postgraduate student in an area where they have a line of sight to the farm which they're actually trying to look after and serve. So in the myriad of all those things is, so in summary, your answer is, number one, it's happening naturally because a lot of farmers now, by reason that they have, if they haven't done a course, a lot of them now have actually been to university, so there's a real understanding of where they can source this information. They're already trained up a better than they would have been in the 1920s. Because farms are bigger, it insists on greater capital intensiveness, especially when you think of yield monitors and just what we're talking about today. It almost demands that the person know more about their industry. Number three, if it's there's going to be you have to get the calibrations right, which also demands that you understand the differentiations between your nitrogen, your phosphorus, your limes, if you need it, your differentiation between your malleacidic soils and your Liverpool plains or right up to Tully. These are all things demand that a person is naturally, not only does the extension officer go out to them, but they have to go back to their source and understand it. Even the purchase of plant demands that the person has a better capacity, but overlaying all that, we also have to invest in the next stage of that sort of that DPI, Department of Ag, process of having the trial pots in the area and getting the farmers in and saying, you know, this is where we think it's working for this district, and working together to get that rolled out.
Barnaby, it's been very good of you to give us some time on what is a sitting day, the last sitting day, I think, before you rise, before the winter, and you've got a lot on your plate. So we're very glad you're in that role. We're very glad you've given us some time this morning. And can I ask that we show our appreciation in the normal way and let you, set you free.
Welcome.